Hey! Oh! What are you? An astronaut?
No, I'm some kind of bubble boy.
The bubble is the co-star of this film. If it weren't for the bubble, I probably wouldn't be very funny.
My feelings on a bubble suit was that it really needed to be something that was funny looking.
When we started out long ago, it was all about doing monsters and doing makeup, and as we got deeper and deeper into it, we were finding out that really what we were doing was coming up with characters, and we didn't want to just be limited to big slobbering monster guys in suits and that sort of thing. So when we sort of expanded our approach to really encompass the characters, we were also finding that there were a lot of other opportunities outside of the monster realm, and it really fit in well with Bubble Boy, because the biggest part of our contribution to this show was the creation of the bubble suit as a character.
Okay, good.
When we first were presented with the script by Beau Flynn, we read it and we thought, okay, this is something very different. I mean, we can see that there are circus freaks in it and there could be makeup opportunities, that's clear. But this inflatable suit that this guy wears around, you know, how do we fit into this? Obviously, we've done a lot of suit construction. We worked on the Alien movies. We worked for Disney before with the Santa Claus. We did the fat makeups and the bodysuit for that. But this was something that was very different. We started to do was to produce sketches and designs based on a kind of an idea that he was taking pieces of inflatable furniture and shower curtains, anything plastic, and building his own homemade bubble suit out of it. You can see he used the shower curtain sort of in the area of his waist, a baby monitor he had attached to his kind of helmet area. And the waders and boots and gloves and so on are things that survived in this version.
This was a more upright, less of a round circle bubble type thing, again making use of a shower curtain design that was tucked in the back to look almost like a turkey tail. It also made use of a vinyl bopping clown, sort of punching clown as a sleeve. We were into big way in finding things that might be in Jimmy's room that would be incorporated into suits at this time.
This is one that was kind of an overinflated version. Also had a desk lamp that would provide its own lighting source. We thought would be fun in a sort of a spoof of science fiction suits that are always, you know, internally lit. When Blair Hayes came on to direct, he had a different approach, and he said to us, he said, you know, these are all great. The artwork looks nice, fellas, but here's what I was thinking. And he drew a little oval with 2 feet sticking out of it. And at first we thought, you know, is he joking? And then he said, and here's the idea behind it. And he had a whole sort of philosophy about it being this sort of little eggshell that this innocent guy is inside. And it all made perfect sense. And we changed our direction.
I think one of the reasons that I even got this movie is because I came into the folks at Touchstone and the producers and with this, a little wind-up toy that was a soccer ball with 2 little feet, and I just wound it up and I put it down on the table and I said, that's what Bubble Boy should look like.
Even though the bubble was simplified, it still necessitated another generation of drawings, and we also did some very rough sculptures to show proportions and just show what this bubble would look like in true 3D form.
Once we got the approval and Blair said, yes, I think this is the right way to go, we all took meetings at ADI. The guys at ADI were fantastic, very, very collaborative. We got it down, we did a number of prototypes.
Barry Robeson had wonderful ideas in terms of the art direction and the color and so on, color scheme inside, and his input was very valuable. We spent some long hours with him with boxes and boxes of bits and pieces that he had collected, that we had collected, and dressing them on a mannequin and going through and hot gluing this piece there and sticking a fan over here and so on.
The first bubble they had designed and that I had gone in to was very constrictive. It was very funny the way I walked in it and the way it forced me to walk, but I wanted to be able to walk that way and have the control over the bubble rather than the bubble having control over me.
Jimmy! Come to mommy!
It's basically a large off-center egg shape. And then to that, all the attachments which hold it to the body, including a backpack, which we've completely fabricated from a lot of existing parts, as well as some custom parts that we've made. We also have tethers, cables that run from the backpack rig down to the inside of the bubble that are hidden within different sorts of connectors. One of them looks like an electrical cord. Others just look like sort of nondescript hoses, and all of the sort of the color and bits of technology that were added to make it more interesting to look at. The hands were custom-built gloves where we took the idea of regular rubber gloves, but we did our own sculptures because we even wanted to make the fingers and hands a little more cartoony, so we customized those and cast up dozens of pairs of gloves that were also added to the suit.
It's also puffy hair.
Yeah, I like as well.
The surface of the bubble is a vinyl material, and we knew from the very start that it had to be some type of vinyl because it had to be see-through, it had to be strong and durable, because even though we created probably 15 or 20 different bubble suit skins, it still had to withstand a certain amount of distress during shooting. There were a lot of concerns about the reflection of lights, reflections of the entire camera crew basically shooting on the outside of a huge bubble. And there were a lot of tests that we went through in terms of dulling down the surface to knock down the reflectivity.
When I first read the script, it was the very first thing I said. I'm like, okay, here's a big plastic 360-degree reflective surface, and you know, my biggest fear was we were going to see everything. We were going to see the camera people and the crew and the trucks and the lights. And in the end, we kind of dealt with some things with the plastic, and it wasn't as big a problem, luckily, that I originally thought it would be.
Like a lizard on a rock.
There were concerns about the temperature difference inside the bubble. If it's too cool inside the bubble to keep the actor comfortable and it's hot outside, is there going to be condensation on the inside of the bubble? And there were a lot of little elements to it that we sort of arrived at solutions in a trial by error sort of way.
Yeah, originally we had a backpack mounted fan unit with an intake, an air intake that Jake would wear on the inside that would keep the bubble inflated, which was fine, but it presented a sound problem when he was mic'd and you could hear the fan running. It also added weight on him, and our objective with each version of the bubble suit was to decrease the weight.
The first bubble that I tried on was 65 pounds, filled with toothpaste and a brush and a comb, like everything all over. And it was basically kind of like the Cadillac of bubbles when it first started out.
Which, even though it was supported mostly from the weight and from the shoulders of the backpack that Jake was wearing, still, you know, it's like carrying around, you know, a couple sacks of dog food, you know, supported on your shoulders and your hips all day long. That's impossible. It's too much of a task for any actor to do.
Jake was really great about the fittings. He really did endure a lot. He started off, you know, putting on a 65-pound suit and smiling, saying, "Yes, I think I can make this work." And you know, the reality was that it was just too cumbersome. So I think we went through, from that point on, I think we went through about four different iterations where we stripped it down, kept, you know, changing things out, down to where we would weigh each piece that was going into it individually and say, okay, here's a piece that weighs 10 ounces. Can we gut it and drill holes in it to make it weigh 6 ounces? Because every little bit helped. And I think we ended up probably cutting the weight in half for him. But our goal was that he wasn't weightlifting during his performance, that he was actually acting.
Before, and I just fell out of a dead man's car, and my parents are about to come pick me up, and this is the girl I love staying with here, and I was just wondering, could I borrow it?
Yeah, sure.
Thanks.
I do have to say, I have so much sympathy for Jake, because you can't hear anything when you're inside the bubble, and, you know, the fundamental of acting is listening. So it's just really challenging. It's like living in a fishbowl or trying to act when you're underwater. Not to mention you can't breathe, you know, they have to constantly fill it with hairdryer air, and it's just, it's crazy.
It's an interesting environment to be in, but it has its ups and its downs. You know, when it's really, really hot, it sort of works as a magnifying glass. And like, do you know those, like, if you take a magnifying glass and like shine it up to like a bug, and you can burn the bug? I mean, I never did that, but I'm sort of like the burning little bug.
I don't know how anybody could have, anybody other than somebody like Jake, you know, a young, you know, 20-year-old actor would have ever put up with this nonsense.
Remember, this is for the public. There are three or four technicians here on set with Jake at all times because it's a complicated apparatus. It's not unlike a large beach ball. When Jake puts it on, he has to step into the leggings.
Into these nice little rubber boots on my feet. And then we pull it up, and they're waders, and they attach to a backpack. And the backpack fits rather tight, and it's on all the weight rests on my hips. And it put the bubble over me, and we blow it up, a lot of air. And then the air pressure blows my ears out every day. It's actually like, it's like being a diver. It's kind of, you know, as soon as they fill the air up, you know, you have to equalize.
You want $500? You want $500?
Comedy is more difficult because it acts on a different part of the brain, I think. I think that if you overshoot, it's just dumb.
There's sort of a notion that things are going to be a little easier on a comedy. You can kind of skate by. The audience is going to be more accepting, and it's really not the case. It's more disciplined because you're in a comedic world, and if what we're doing is not realistic, it's going to expose the comedy. It's sort of like kind of winking at the audience, saying we're all in on the gag, and that's not the case. The bubble suit, for as comedic as the image is, if you look past that image, it's got to look like a realistic thing that this kid has built, as capable of sustaining his life. Otherwise, the gag is blown.